They say you shouldn't judge books by their cover, but nice cover art does help, especially when you're an artist. I find myself reading romances or mystery, so two sides of the extreme scale. It's either going to be kind of coming of age stories or stories that have twists, because I love a good twist and a good surprise. I have a library card at my local library, which is the Jefferson Parish Library, kind of right down the street from me. And while I haven't been able to go very much because of quarantine, I do still check out books doing a contactless checkout and use the ebook function so I can listen to audiobooks. I have been listening to this on audiobook on and off while also reading it, so that's been fun. So I originally bought it because I thought the cover was really nice, but then as I started to read it, I got really interested in the mystery element with all of the inn guests. So the Greenglass House is an inn for smugglers, where these kind of weird, nefarious characters come to pawn things off in the town. And each guest has a mystery surrounding them where they're being kind of suspicious, but also suspicious of the other guests. So the whole book is really trying to figure out what's going on with the guests and why there is a map in someone's wallet. Chapter 1, The Smuggler's Inn. There is a right way to do things and a wrong way. If you're going to run a hotel in a smuggler's town, you shouldn't make it a habit to ask too many questions, for one thing. And you probably shouldn't be in it for the money. Smugglers are always going to be flush with cash as soon as they find a buyer for the 8 cartons of fountain pen cartridges that write in illegal shades of green, but they never have money today. You should, if you are going to run a smuggler's hotel, get a big account book and assume that whatever you write in it, the reality is you're going to get paid in fountain pen cartridges, if you're lucky. You could just as easily get paid with something even more useless. Milo Pine did not run a smuggler's hotel, but his parents did. It was an inn, actually. A huge, ramshackle manor house that looked as if it had been cobbled together from discarded pieces of a dozen mismatched mansions collected from a dozen different cities. It was called Greenglass House, and it sat on the side of a hill overlooking an inlet of harbors, a little district built half off the shore and half on the piers that jutted out into the river, skidrack like the teeth of a comb. It was a long climb up to the inn from the waterfront by foot, or an only slightly shorter trip by the cable railway that led from the inn's private dock up to the sleep stope of Wilforber Hill. And of course the inn wasn't only for smugglers, but that was who turned up most often, so that was how Milo thought of it. Milo had lived at Greenglass House ever since he'd been adopted by Nora and Ben Pine when he was a baby. It had always been home, and he was used to the bizarre folks who passed through the inn, some of them coming back every season, like extended family who showed up to pinch your cheeks at holidays and then disappeared again. After 12 years, he was even getting pretty good at predicting who was going to show up when. Smugglers were like bugs or vegetables. They had their seasons, which was why it was so weird when the huge old bell on the porch, the one that was connected to the winch that drove the cable that in turn hauled the car up its tracks, started ringing. The old iron bell's tone changed with the seasons too, and with the time of day. This evening, The first of winter vacation was cold and brittle, and the snow had just begun to fall. Today, therefore, the bell itself had a brittle tone. It had a sound like a gulp of frigid air. Milo looked up from the coffee table, where he was working on a math problem. He liked to get his homework out of the way off the bat so he could enjoy the holidays without thinking about school. He glanced at his mother, who was sprawled across the rag rug in front of the big stone fireplace, reading. "Someone's coming up?" he asked incredulously. Mrs. Pine got to her feet, tucked her book under her arm, padded across to the foyer, and peered out the window by the door. "Someone wants to. We'd better go start the winch." "But we never have guests the first week of vacation," Milo protested. He felt a vague unease start to rise in his stomach and tried to swallow it down. Vacation couldn't possibly get spoiled so quickly, could it? He'd only stepped off the launch that ferried the Quayside kids to and from school a few hours ago. "Well, not often we don't," Mrs. Pine said as she laced up her boots. "But that's not because we have a rule about it. It's just because that's the way it usually turns out." "But it's vacation!" His mother shrugged and held out his coat. "Come on, kiddo, be a gentleman. Don't send your mom out into the cold alone."